This is Duke University.
Three main questions. What's your definition of education? What's your definition of democracy? And what do you see as the connection between the two?
Education is not easy to define. The way, in this context, we have to understand it, I think, is as an institutional procedure by which in society one generation provides instruction and experience to the forthcoming generations through a formal system of schooling. Really, education is such a placeholder commonly used for schooling. The oldest form of schooling is really homeschooling, but the only way homeschooling can be done really very well is by the very wealthy, as it was done in the 18th century among aristocrats. But schooling is a function of modern society and modern industrial society and urban society, where actually it's a practical way of educating large numbers of people, especially at a time when knowledge is a crucial component of economic and social power. So literacy, knowledge, provides a society with a competitive edge in an extremely competitive world. So education is a system of instruction that is controlled and designed by an adult population for a childhood population and for young adults, and starts often in preschool and ends in the university years. Now, democracy is a very complicated subject as well. And you can divide in a simple way between two ways of looking at democracy. One is a procedural way, in which the issues are largely about process. Is it a form of government by which the process defines the outcome, so there are elections, that democracy is the power of the many as opposed to the few nominally, and that is protected by a process of controlling who is in power through a citizenry. And the method that's most commonly adopted is that of elections. So we define democracies about whether they're free elections. That's a procedural definition. I rather think one needs to look at the substantive definition, that a democracy is not a society that through free election can decide to eliminate freedom, can't properly vote a certain set of rules, even though they may be popular, that would undercut certain aspects of democracy that we associate with freedom and the liberty of the individual. So that's why in political theory there's often a distinction made between the will of the majority, or the will of everyone, and what's right for the society. That's why we have something called the Bill of Rights. One could actually get laws passed by a huge majority which eliminate the protections of the Bill of Rights. You could get a majority of American citizens to agree that freedom of speech is a bad thing, and freedom of religion is a bad thing. But that would be irrelevant. Even at moments in our history when intolerance is at its highest, there is the protection of certain principles which are substantive. Those principles include, in our version of democracy, protection of the natural rights by some argument. That's what's inscribed in the Declaration of Independence. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Those formulas can change, but they include the freedom of the individual, freedom of movement, freedom of conscience, freedom of expression. We don't like those freedoms, by the way. These are things we only say easily, but we actually don't do them very easily. So that's the notion of democracy. And the third thing you asked about?
What do you see as the connection between education and democracy?
Well, the university is at the focal point, if you will, between the two. Because the university is about the unlimited investigation of the truth and the protection of the unlimited range of dissent. University is the place in which people are allowed to speculate and to investigate without regard to sacred cows of any kind. There's no such thing as heresy in the modern university. There's only the what would one ideally see as the free debate of ideas. That the discourse that the university supports, whether in research or in scholarship or in discussion, doesn't have boundaries of propriety. The range of freedom in the university in speech is wider than the range of freedom we would tolerate outside of the university. People can suggest hypotheses regarding the external world that some people consider absurd. But the university also, for example, believes that you cannot simply speak and not have your ideas tested. So although outside of the university you can say anything you want, in the university you have to tolerate the criticism that saying something brings. You can't get up and say five things and then walk away. You have to be able, let's say, if you believe the earth is flat, you're entitled in the university to get up and say, I'm giving my flat earth lecture. But then somebody gets up and starts to show you why, in fact, that might be false. And you can't simply say, I'm not going to listen. Or you can't say, your time is up. People want to put forward theories of various kinds. They're entitled to, but they have to listen to the criticism. Discussion in the university is not one way. It's an exchange. It's not a one-way form of declaration. Unlike the way we live in society, where we can choose whom we talk to. I go on the internet, I only look at those sites that agree with me. Most people go to public events only to hear what they already know. Nobody likes to go to an event. They clap when they agree, and they boo when they don't agree. And in fact, they sign up for the event if they know ahead of time that they'll be made comfortable, because it will simply confirm their own prejudices. The university doesn't operate that way. What you have to listen to and think about may not cohere with what you believe. And you will actually have to see things you hold sacred contested. Because the university has an extreme commitment to the exploration of knowledge and truth without sectarian or ideological boundaries. And the rules of evidence, and the rules of argument, and the rules of debate are what we hold in common. So, and there's a transparency to the way free speech is conducted. So the relation of education and democracy is the very simple belief. And this is a tragic hope because the reality doesn't speak to it. So something is wrong. The original idea of the relation of education and democracy rests in an 18th century conceit. And that is, if you educate the public, they will be good citizens. Meaning they'll exercise the right to vote. They will exercise the right to vote by studying the issues. They'll understand their own prejudices. The way, for example, if you look at some of the debates before the Civil War, the defenders of slavery understood very well what they were defending. And they attempted their best to persuade people that slavery was justified. Now, the fact remains that the notion that an education would lead to an effective democracy, and that citizenship was contingent on the education you could receive to exercise democracy. So, for example, should we intervene in the Libyan civil war? Well, in order to make that decision, you'd have to understand something about Libya, know something about civil wars, know something about the history of the Middle East, you have to find Libya on the map, you have to know something about the economics of Libya, you have to know about the history of intervention, you have to read debates about people who make different claims about whether these interventions work or they don't work, and so forth and so on. In fact, to make an informed decision. You need to be able to decide whether or not we should intervene or not intervene in helping Japan with its nuclear disaster. Well, you have to understand, how does a nuclear reactor work? How can you make a decision without knowing? You watch all this scare news about cooling and radiation. Well, what is radiation? How do you measure the effect of radiation in terms of its harm? What is harmful radiation? What are the standards? What are the risks? If it went to a certain level, what is the statistical basis, of illness and what kind of illness? What do we know about it? What we don't know about it? How do we understand the problem? What is the cooling all about? And so forth. In order to be intelligent as a citizen in making a judgment about these things, education is required. That's the premise. That's the link between a well-ordered democracy that runs freely and protects freedom and one that is run simply by ignorance, fear, and by people who vote without understanding what they're voting about. Well, the fact is, in the United States, we have a complicated reality. More people have gone to school now than ever before in American history. There are more people holding degrees, spent longer in school than ever before, or in the voting population, and never has the quality of our political debate been lower. The standard of politics sunk so low, the sloganeering, the simplification of complex issues, the intolerance we have for the people who don't agree with us. So why is the political debate sinking so low and the access to education so high and the levels of educational achievement growing? This is a paradox. It essentially defies the 18th century prediction. So in our discussion here today, we have to ask the question, is there no link between education and democracy? Or perhaps there is a link, or perhaps there's something in our educational system that isn't right. I rather think that's the case. I'm an optimist. If we could fix the educational system, actually, we would help the future of democracy.
Produced by Duke University.